You know, God's Word is so wonderful and so varied. You know, how could you ever get all the wisdom there is out of the book? Every time I read it, I think, well, where did that come from? I don't remember seeing that before. You can spend years in the Bible and there's always something new and fresh. Why? Because it is the living Word. It has more life than anything you can get in this life. You know, you may take vitamins. I do. I think they're great. You may eat correctly. I try to eat correctly. That's good because we need that kind of life. Exercising is good for us, getting our rest, taking care of our physical body. It brings life to it, keeps it alive, keeps it going. But you know what? The greatest life you can find is in God's Word. And we've been looking at the book of Revelation, and we are seeing life. And we are seeing light for this end time. And God wants to give you light. I'm so glad you're watching this program. And some of you have watched Revelation from the very beginning. I'm so delighted you are, because I know God is going to bless you and give you revelation knowledge out of the book of Revelation. Now, in case you have missed, or missed even some of it, remember our outline. Get the outline. You know, we are racing through this book. I know you think that, wow, we're hurrying to get through here, but we have 1 month, and I have about 27 minutes every day to teach you, so we are racing. We're getting the overall picture of the book of outline of Revelation. We're not looking under every rock, the overall picture. But if you get this outline, it will help you no end. If you just write and ask for it, it's free. That's easy, isn't it? So write today. Don't put it off. Say, I want the book of Revelation outline, and we'll send it to you. And if you've missed anything or if you haven't missed anything, you still need the outline. And you need to go back through and read the Word with the outline, comparing it. Then, folks, it has a much better opportunity to get into your heart. Much, much better. Now today, I'm going to give a little quicker review because I want to spend a little more time reviewing on the last two chapters that we have looked at. I feel they're very important, and then we're going to go into chapter 14. But when we look at the book of Revelation, you can kind of get it and get it clarified in the overall picture if you just kind of set it up like a house. You have the first room, which is the first chapter, and you behold Jesus. You have the second room, which are the second and third chapters, which give you the seven church ages, which are basically Ephesus, if you look at them, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea, and they tell you the overall picture of church history. Then when you get through the second room, you go up to the third room, and the third, fourth, and fifth rooms are like a tri-level house. You go from chapters 4 through 11, and you see the seven-year tribulation period as a viewpoint from heaven. You see the rapture of the church in chapter 4. You see the church very active in administrating the judgment or wrath of God during that 7 years of tribulation. Then you come down to the fourth room, and you see the 7 years all over again, same thing, only you see it from Earth's viewpoint, and that's where we are right now, because we're looking at chapters 12 through 16. Then you go to chapter 17 and 18, that's the fifth room, and you see it from Satan's kingdom, his viewpoint. Then you go into chapters 19 and 20, which is the millennium, that's the sixth room, and then you look at eternity, chapters 21 and 22. So this kind of gives you that overall view of the whole book of Revelation. Once we are caught up into heaven in chapter 4, we see the title deed of the earth is taken by Jesus Christ because he is worthy. Adam lost it, but Jesus, the last Adam, got it back. But Satan doesn't want to give up the earth easily. So Jesus begins to take off the seals of this title deed to the earth. And as he does, God's wrath begins to fall. And that overcoming church that's up there is a part of that. Now, what happens? With the first seal, we see a white horse that comes forth, and we see the gospel is greatly preached in the early 3.5 years of the tribulation. We see a red horse that comes forth, the rise of Antichrist, and a terrible, terrible war. We see out of the war comes famine, that's the black horse, and then out of the famine we see a pale horse, and that is pestilence and death. And so these are terrible things that happen with the Antichrist. He'll have a short period of peace, but he will basically bring the world to havoc. The fifth seal, we see that the church that did not go in the rapture, the leftover church, the remnant church, is going to be here terribly persecuted by the Antichrist, and they will become martyrs. And so that fifth seal, we see those martyrs, and they're crying out to God. Then the sixth seal, we see cataclysms happen with the sun and the moon and the stars, cataclysms happening in heaven. But the seventh seal is at midway, and that's a real heavy turning point, because now we have the seven trumpets. Now, the seven trumpets, we will start seeing them soon in our chapters 12 through 16, are the same as the seven vials. Because when you look from heaven, it looks like a trumpet. But when you look from earth up, it looks like a vial. So the seven vials and the seven trumpets are the same. It's trumpets is the way you look at it from heaven. Vials is the way you look at it from earth. But they do the same things, very much the same. Okay, now let's look at the trumpets. The first trumpet sounds, fire hits the earth. The second trumpet sounds, fire hits the seas and the oceans. The third trumpet sounds, fire hits the rivers and the water sources on the earth. Why? Because God is going to cleanse the earth with fire. Then we see the fourth trumpet sounds and the sun gets hotter. So all of this is, what is it doing? It is taking the water and evaporating it, because that water is going to go back up in the firmament of water that was around the earth at the very beginning. And the earth is going to return to that original state. Then we see the sixth trumpet sound, or the fifth trumpet sounds, and with this trumpet, see, now wait, did I get all my fires? I got my four, yeah, I did. Okay, when the fifth trumpet sounds, we start into the woes. So these last three trumpets are terrible. They're not on nature, they're on mankind itself and on Satan's kingdom. They are so bad that trumpet sounds, the fifth trumpet sounds, and these evil spirits are released and they bite men, and the sting of it, just they suffer for like 5 months. Then we see another whole group of evil spirits are released, and they come and attack people, especially involved in sexual sins. And it's an awful, awful thing, but it says they do not repent. Then before the seventh trumpet and the third woe occurs, we see chapter 10, which is an exciting chapter. We see Jesus with the title deed of the earth standing, see, and all the seals are gone, standing on the sea, standing on the earth, and really saying, it's mine. And then he takes the title deed and gives it to John, because originally man was to have dominion over the earth, and John is the symbol of that. So John takes that title deed of the earth. Now see, we still have not had that seventh trumpet, but we are getting a preview. It's just about to happen, because we're about to wind up the 7 years looking at it from heaven's viewpoint. So in chapter 11, we see the temple is being measured, because the Antichrist let the Jews build a temple. And we see that he has entered into a covenant with the Jews. But when he persecutes that leftover church, when they are raptured, because they are raptured in the middle of the tribulation, that's a second rapture, it really upsets him. And plus Satan has always so wanted to be worshipped. He sets up an idol, the Antichrist does, and Satan gives it power in the Holy of Holies of the temple itself. And this thing can talk, ugh, say yuck twice, yuck, yuck. And people begin to worship that. And those that won't worship that idol, the Antichrist persecutes, and that's when Jewish believers have to flee. But he gets it too. The Antichrist gets it too. So I just say, ha ha. Because these two witnesses stand up named Moses and Elijah, and they begin to close the heavens, and they begin to call down plagues, and they harass the Antichrist's kingdom no end. They bug him to shreds. And finally he kills them. They lie on the streets of Jerusalem for 3.5 days, and then God says, come up hither, and we have our third rapture, and they are taken up into the heavens. And of course, what an image that is to the whole world. And that really gets the Antichrist super, super upset. And we have the sounding of the seventh trumpet now. And with the sounding of that, we have Armageddon, and we have a great earthquake where the earth goes back to its original position. And we have an overall picture of what heaven was doing in the 7 years, and how we, if we are part of the overcoming church, are involved in it. All right? Now, we have gone 4 through 11. So we've gone 7 years from heaven's viewpoint. We're looking down from heaven's viewpoint. Now 12 through 16 is not going to give all the details that heaven gave. It's just going to show how earth sees what's going on. Okay, so let's keep that in mind. Same thing chronologically, but it won't give all the details. It'll give different details. But it'll all agree and tie together in the mouth of two or three witnesses, everything is established. Okay, now, we're at that, what room? We're at the fourth room now. So I want to look at chapter 12 with you and just take a little time. There appears a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet, on her head a crown of 12 stars. And we see she's heavy with child, she's travailing in birth. And we see another wonder in heaven, a red dragon, with 7 heads, 10 horns, 7 crowns upon his heads, and he's waiting for that child to be born. He drags a third of the stars of the heaven with him, which would be Satan and the fallen angels, and he is waiting to grab her child. Who is that child? Now, we're back to like chapter 4 in chronology. This child is the raptured church that is about to be born out of the church itself. It is the overcomers. Satan knows there's going to be a rapture of the church, but what he doesn't know is the day or the hour, because God's not going to let that out. He didn't want Satan trying to stop the rapture. Satan will do everything to try and stop the rapture. The rapture will be a surprise attack on him. We know the signs of it, but we don't know the day or the hour, because the best attacks on the enemy are the ones that they don't know the day or the hour. Now, remember, Satan is the prince of the powers of the air. So when that church rises up through the air, see, he wants to stop the church from going up. That's the baby, the man-child that's going up. But it says that Michael and his angels will come and fight with him to stop him. And the church will go up, and Satan will lose his position in the air. Hallelujah. And his demons, those fallen angels, and they will come down to earth, and man, will they go after the remnant church that's left here, because they'll be so mad that he takes his vengeance out on them. And it says he knows his time is short. Well, he's right about that, because he has about 7 years. So he is really after them in every way. He is angry, angry, angry. Now, remember, we're looking at this, the rapture of the church, from Earth's viewpoint, and we're seeing Satan at work in it. Then in chapter 13, we see where he says he stands on the sand of the sea and he sees a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns, 10 crowns, upon his heads, the name of blasphemy. Now, the next thing after the rapture of the church, and we see Satan fighting it, but we see the rise of the Antichrist. The church is gone. Now the Antichrist has power that he can come forth. Before that time, the church bugged him and he couldn't do it. It describes how he looks. Ooh, he's a hideous looking thing. He's a beast, and I want to look. He has 7 heads and 10 horns, which means he will have the power and the geographical location of these original 7 world powers. Now, who are they? Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, and Antichrist's kingdom. So those will be the 7 world powers that we see. 7 heads. Then we'll see the Antichrist will make war with 3 little kingdoms. It sounds like they're in Europe. Then he will get allegiance of 7 more, and he will have 10 nations that back him. That's these 10 horns. And they will all have crowns on their heads, but they will be involved in blasphemy. So we say, well, then the Antichrist's kingdom basically is the Mideast. That's what I believe. That's what I believe the Bible teaches. Okay, now what is he like? The beast is like a leopard, his feet are like the feet of a bear, his mouth is the mouth of a lion, and the dragon gives him his power. Now see, those original empires had these same things, like Babylon, they called a lion, and they called the bear the Grecian Empire, and they called the leopard the Medes and the Persians. So it will have all of the strengths that these original empires had, and he will have authority. The great authority, but he will get more power because he will totally release himself to Satan. He gets hurt, shot in the head evidently, or hurt, and Satan says, you know, I will give you life if you will let me come into you, and that people will worship the idol you set up, which will be me, really. I'll give it power. Satan has always wanted worship. So the Antichrist gives into this, and of course then he begins to have satanic power. Now remember, this is the beginning of the 7 years, because we're going back and looking at it from Earth's viewpoint. So we see this terrible Antichrist coming up, and then he has another man that works with him called a false prophet. And he comes and prophesies and acts really religious, and says everybody should worship the Antichrist, and that hideous image that is set up of the Antichrist in the Holy of Holies, the abomination of desolation. And so, you know, everybody is going after the Antichrist, and he is deceiving them. It says that he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. So, folks, we shouldn't be ignorant about these times that are coming. So, what will it be? It says, here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. You say, who is this 666 that gets people to take his image and, you know, put it on their hand or in their forehead? I believe it is the satanic trinity. I believe 666 can be a number that is used for evil. Satan is a six, he's an evil. The Antichrist is a six, he is evil. And his false prophet is six, he is evil. I believe it is that three satanic trinity. And so, though it's going to be heavy in these first 3.5 years of tribulation with what the Antichrist is going to pull. But always God has a people who love him and serve him. So now he looks, you know, and we see on earth a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 having his father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven as the voice of many waters and the voice of great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders, and no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being first fruits unto God and to the Lamb, and in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Now, there is a remnant of Jewish people who get born again at the beginning of this tribulation period. They are the 144,000. We saw them sealed back here in Revelation, if you remember, right at the very beginning, before things began to hit the earth too heavy duty. In chapter 7, the 144,000 were sealed to protect them from the trumpet judgments. Now, see, we're in chronology that is the same as chapter 4 through 11. We looked at it from heaven's viewpoint, but now we're seeing earth's viewpoint, and we're seeing these 144,000 and how they are turned on to God. They're not into idolatry at all. Now we see an angel. We see angels in heaven bringing the gospel. So in the early part of the tribulation, these angels and people from heaven, overcoming Christians, are going to be sending the gospel to the earth. And this is verse 6. And it says, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of the water. Now what is this angel saying? He is saying with the same timing as the white horse went forth bringing the gospel with the seal. So he is a part of that first seal, and he is coming and preaching and saying, oh, you know, get right with God. Bad times are coming. God always sends grace before he sends wrath. And so this angel is coming and preaching. Then another angel comes, and he preaches too. And he preaches the future. It hasn't happened, but he's telling them what's going to happen. He's talking about Satan's kingdom. He said, Babylon has fallen, that great city, because she made all the nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now, we're not going to get into this heavy duty until we get to Revelation 17 and 18. Now this angel comes and says, hey, this is the gospel, this is the good news, but let me tell you the bad news. Babylon, which is a really evil religious system of Satan, Satan will have his own church, said it's falling. And Satan will have his own commercial city too. See, Revelation 17 is his religious Babylon. Revelation 18 is his commercial Babylon. So it's saying, it's falling. Said, it's made all nations drunk with the wine. When did this Babylon start? It started, this false religious system started with Nimrod and the Tower of Babel. It's never ended. That's always been Satan's church. You know, people say, oh, Satanism, it's always been around. It's not new. It might have been a little more hidden. But the occult and garbage like that and false church has always been there. And so he says, it's going to fall. It's going to fall. And he said, get out of her. Now, the third angel comes, and all of this is under that white horse seal that we saw. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone, and the presence of the holy angels, and the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascended up forever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night who worship the beast in his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Now it's saying, see, you say, well, what are they going to preach in the first 3.5 years of the tribulation? What you're seeing here? That's what Earth is seeing. See, Earth is not getting all the detail that heaven got. This is what Earth sees. It sees the preaching that is coming forth of the gospel, the fall of Babylon, and not taking the mark of the beast. See, the Antichrist is up here stirring things up. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. It's going to be so bad, it'd be more blessed to be dead. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. And I looked, and behold a white cloud, and upon the cloud one sat like unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, thrust in your sickle and reap, for the time has come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. And he that sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle in the earth, and the earth was reaped. Now what is he going to reap? See, these angels are preaching what is future and going to come. Jesus is going to reap Armageddon, and the evil spirits are going to gather the nations of the world to Armageddon, come down to fight with Jerusalem. And another angel came out of the temple which is in heaven. He is also having a sharp sickle. And another angel came out from the altar which had power of fire, and cried with a loud voice to him that had the sharp sickle, saying, thrust in thy sharp sickle, and gather the cluster of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe. In other words, sin has come to its fullness. It's time. Let them go down there, because God is going to move on the scene. And the angel thrust his sickle into the earth, and gathered the vine of the earth, and cast it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trodden without the city, and blood came out of the winepress, even unto the horse bridles by the space of 1,600 furlongs. So he's preaching, it hasn't happened yet, but he's preaching of Armageddon that is coming. So in these first 3.5 years, there will be tremendous preaching coming from heaven, preparing people not to take the image of the Antichrist, but to serve Jesus Christ. So we have been looking from Earth's viewpoint at the early part of the tribulation, like the first 3.5 years, but don't miss 15, because 15 are the trumpets, only they're called vials. So our next thing now is very important for you to get the picture of. Now there's something else that's really important for you, and that is to be in my Bible Encounter in Colorado Springs. What a beautiful time to come to Colorado. You know what the dates are? May 22nd through the 24th. Springtime in the Rockies, but springtime in God's Word, because in 21 hours, we are going to walk through the Bible and behold Jesus in every book of the Bible. Have you ever done that? You get the total essence and character of God. Now let me look. Obstacle lane.